a new world order can emerge. Now we can see a new world coming into...
For the first time in history, a truly global society carried up by the principle of interdependence. And if we act wisely and with vision, I think we can look back to all this turmoil as...
Are we at one of those moments in history in which there is the necessity for a new world order? A, because of what's taken place in the Middle East, the rise of different kinds of groups, and B, what's happened in Asia, meaning that there has been a shift from the West to the East.
There's a need for a new world order. Nevertheless, the United States is in a key position to shape this so that the problem of the Bush presidency will be the emergence of a new international order.
Within the next 4 years, we will see the emergence of a new international order.
The beginning of a new international order.
Order. We have before us the opportunity to forge for ourselves and for future generations, a new world order, a world where the rule of law, not the law of the jungle, governs the conduct of nations. When we are successful, and we will be, we have a real chance at this new world order, an order in which a credible United Nations can use its peacekeeping role to fulfill the promise and vision of the UN's founders.
What is at stake is more than one small country. It is a big idea, a new world order, where diverse nations are drawn together in common cause to achieve the universal aspirations of mankind, peace and security, freedom, and the rule of law.
Out of these troubled times, our fifth objective, a new world order, can emerge. Now we can see a new world coming into view. A world in which there is a very real prospect of a new world order.
The Council on Foreign Relations, known as the CFR, an organization publicly sworn to destroy American national sovereignty and usher in a tyrannical world police state, could not contain their glee on September 12th, the day after the tragic attack. They announced their New World Order.
There is a chance for the President of the United States to use this disaster to carry out what his father, a phrase his father used, I think, only once.
Myself, that we needed a new world order, and instead it looks like we got a...
France intends to pursue, together with all people of goodwill around the world, this battle to build the new world order of the 21st century.
A new world is emerging. It is a new world order with significantly different and radically new challenges.
I think even that does not describe why the world has changed so much and why the world has turned so much toward a new world order.
The decade of the 1990s was meant to have been one in which a new international order, free of the bipolar rivalry of earlier days, was to have been established. Australia is a Western nation. Nothing can, will, or should alter that fact. As such, in this new world, we are a terrorist
target. Si richiede dunque un nuovo sforzo di coesione nazionale e un concreto impegno per garantire la pace anche al di fuori dei confini della stessa Europa, per contribuire alla creazione di un nuovo ordine mondiale.
For institutions of freedom have lain dormant. The United Nations can offer them new life. These institutions play a crucial role in our quest for a new world order.
And sure enough, a lot happened on his watch that was very, very positive towards a new world order.
The President George Bush has talked time and time again about a new world order. And this is the best chance to begin to establish the new world order.
After 1989, President Bush kept said, and it's a phrase that I often use myself, that we needed a new world order.
And jobs cost American sovereignty, but it would fulfill the president's father's vision. Bill Tucker reports.
It's not a new idea. President Bush talked about it back in 1991.
It is a big idea, a new world order, where diverse nations are drawn together in common cause.
Now former United States Trade Ambassador Robert Zoellick is talking about it again with renewed vigor. This time a new world order with business at the helm of trade and economic policy.
All these new challenges are bringing together about the biggest restructuring we have ever seen, not just of the global economy, but of the global order as a whole. And 200 years ago, a famous British Foreign Secretary said that the new world had been called into existence to redress the balance of the old. In 1990, another old world ended, dominated by the Cold War, and people talked then, in 1990, of a new world order. What they actually meant then was a new political order. And what was not foreseen then, but is obvious now from everything that we see and do, what we experience in every day of our life, is the sheer scale and speed and scope of globalization. And it's only now that we can begin to understand that the world order that globalization brings and what it's going to look like, it's driven forward now not just by the balance of military strength, the Cold War times, or ordinary political power. It's being driven forward by a seismic shift in economic power that we see around us. But what does the New World Order mean for countries like ours who are looking to succeed? I suggest that the countries that are going to succeed are those that combine flexibility, free trade, open markets, with proper stewardship of the environment and investment in education, infrastructure and innovation. And the question for us is how we meet and master all these challenges to ensure that Britain enhances its competitiveness in the process and realise realizes what I believe is our destiny of success in this new world order. So, in conclusion, ladies and gentlemen, the world is emerging. It is a new world.
Together with all people of goodwill around the world, this battle to build the new world order of
the 21st century. Even greater than at the time of the Industrial Revolution, a new world order was created. But today, with Asia already outproducing Europe, India and China are clearly becoming part of our new order.
Let me say very clearly that we are not focused, as some have suggested, on establishing a new world order, but rather bringing order to a new world.
The World Federalist Association, or WFA, is one of the largest organizations that openly promote world government. Periodically, the WFA extends a Global Governance Award to a prominent individual pushing for the same goal. Former CBS anchorman Walter Cronkite was among the recipients of the WFA Award.
Thank you very much. Today we must develop federal structures on a global level to deal with world problems. We need a system of enforceable world law, a democratic federal world government.
In a closed-circuit hookup, Hillary Clinton congratulated Cronkite.
For decades, you told us the way it is. But tonight, we honor you for fighting for the way it could be.
The Norman Cousins Global Governance Award, Walter Cronkite. World government is the structure necessary for global justice. You, sir. You, sir, have been a lifelong advocate of this principle, and it is appropriate, therefore, that we present you with this amethyst geode.
Good evening and congratulations, Walter, on receiving the World Federalist Association's Global Governance Award. For more than a generation in America, it wasn't the news until Walter Cronkite told us it was the news. Every night at 6 o'clock, we welcomed you into our living rooms and listened as you explained the complex events of the day. Whether it was the space race or the Vietnam War, presidential elections, or peace treaties, you were there, telling us in simple yet riveting prose what was happening. You became a trusted member of my family and the families across America. For decades, you told us the way it is. But tonight, we honor you for fighting for the way it could be. We honor you for lending your voice to the cause of human rights around the world and for your lifelong commitment to international human rights law. From your reporting on the Nuremberg trials to your work with the WFA campaign to end genocide, you have stirred our consciences and challenged all of us to live closer to the words of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. All human beings are born free and equal in dignity and rights. So thank you, Walter. Thank you for inspiring all of us to build a more peaceful and just world. We are still listening to your every word. And with your continuing leadership, we can sail across these unnavigated seas into the 21st century. And there's no better captain I can imagine than you. Thank you.
In 1993, the WFA honored an editor for Time magazine for an essay he had written entitled The Birth of a Global Nation.
Nationhood as we know it will be obsolete. All states will recognize a single global authority.
After receiving the award, the editor, Strobe Talbott, was appointed Deputy Secretary of State in the Clinton administration. In February of 2000, the New York Times allowed the WFA a full-page ad to spread its globalist propaganda.
Is not whether they are politically agile and whether they're smart and whether they're savvy. All of those things they are. I think the big question is whether they have the capacity to construct a conceptual framework for American policy for the years ahead. We have lacked such a framework over the last few years since the Berlin Wall collapsed. the consensus we had, the understanding we had about what our purpose and what our role in the world should be, what the underlying tenets of American foreign policy obviously had disappeared, and no one yet has been able to come up with a coherent framework. George Bush tried. You remember just after the war against, well, during the conflict with Saddam Hussein, which he handled so superbly in a short-term sense, but he kept talking about a new world order. And then President Bush, at the end of that war, promised he would give four commencement addresses, describing that new world order and what America's role was going to be in it. Turned out he gave one of those addresses and canceled the other three and talked about something else. That's what, because they weren't ready yet to define that new framework. And we've had that same absence of a framework during the Clinton administration. It is, I think, the biggest challenge facing us, because it not only can give us a sense of where we are going, but it also can help in bringing the American people more fully into the support of what we're trying to do, because people now don't quite understand it. It seems very
that you see before you represent not the past, but rather the future. It is through exercises such as this that truly we can create a new world order.
Ladies and gentlemen, the very word secrecy is repugnant in a free and open society. And we are, as a people, inherently and historically opposed to secret societies, to secret oaths, and to secret proceedings. We decided long ago that the dangers of excessive and unwarranted concealment of pertinent facts far outweighed the dangers which are cited to justify it. Even today, there is little value in opposing the threat of a closed society by imitating its arbitrary restrictions. Even today, there is little value in ensuring the survival of our nation if our traditions do not survive with it. And there is very grave danger that an announced need for increased security will be seized upon by those anxious to expand its meaning to the very limits of official censorship and concealment. That I do not intend to permit to the extent that it's in my control. And no official of my administration, whether his rank is high or low, civilian or military, should interpret my words here tonight as an excuse to censor the news, to stifle dissent, to cover up our mistakes, or to withhold from the press and the public the facts they deserve to know. For we are opposed around the world by a monolithic and ruthless conspiracy that relies primarily on covert means for expanding its sphere of influence, on infiltration instead of invasion, on subversion instead of elections, on intimidation instead of free choice, on guerrillas by night instead of armies by day. It is a system which has conscripted vast human and material resources into the building of a tightly knit, highly efficient machine that combines military, diplomatic, intelligence, economic, scientific, and political operations. Its preparations are concealed, not published. Its mistakes are buried, not headlined. Its dissenters are silenced, not praised. No expenditure is questioned, no rumor is printed, no secret is revealed. No president should fear public scrutiny of his program. For from that scrutiny comes understanding, and from that understanding comes support or opposition, and both are necessary. I am not asking your newspapers to support an administration, but I am asking your help in the tremendous task of informing and alerting the American people. for I have complete confidence in the response and dedication of our citizens whenever they are fully informed. I not only could not stifle controversy among your readers, I welcome it. This administration intends to be candid about its errors. For as a wise man once said, an error doesn't become a mistake until you refuse to correct it. We intend to accept full responsibility for our errors, and we expect you to point them out when we miss them. Without debate, without criticism, no administration and no country can succeed, and no republic can survive. That is why the Athenian lawmaker Solon decreed it a crime for any citizen to shrink from controversy. And that is why our press was protected by the First Amendment, the only business in America specifically protected by the Constitution, not primarily to amuse and entertain, not to emphasize the trivial and the sentimental, not to simply give the public what it wants, but to inform, to arouse, to reflect, to state our dangers and our opportunities, to indicate our crises and our choices, to lead, mold, educate, and sometimes even anger public opinion. This means greater coverage and analysis of international news, for it is no longer far away and foreign, but close at hand and local. It means greater attention to improved understanding of the news, as well as improved transmission. And it means, finally, that government at all levels must meet its obligation to provide you with the fullest possible information outside the narrowest limits of national security. And so it is to the printing press, to the recorder of man's deeds, the keeper of his conscience, the courier of his news, that we look for strength and assistance, confident that with your help, man will be what he was born to be, free.
The reason is because the society is the only organization in America that is organized at the grassroots level with paid coordinators, with chapters in the communities all across the country.
Conservative caucus.
Not with chapters, not with a paid field staff all across the country. And so the result is that this is the one group, I think, that those who would radically change America seriously fear. And a tremendous campaign was launched in December of 1960 to move to discredit the John Birch Society and, frankly, launched an issue of being a longstanding member of the Rockefeller apparatus. And as a member of the Council on Foreign Relations of longstanding, you're fully aware that there is an elitist core in this country that has seen value in subsidizing communism, of protecting communism.
It has?
Sure.
You're accusing me of subsidizing communism?
No, I'm saying
because
that
I happen to belong to a...
There is an elite core in this country that has dominated American society.
Well, I'm not one of them.
The Trilateral Commission,
Council on Foreign Relations.
State Department, I suppose.
Well, let's face it, they've dominated the State Department for 40 years, and pretty much openly.
Right,
so.
But what are they trying to do?
Well, their objective is to try to bring about a gradual transition in our society, a dissolving of sovereignty, and a moving steadily to the left on the political spectrum.
Well, who are they?
The elitist groups that I mentioned, particularly key individuals and policymakers in the Council on Foreign Relations.
Is the International Monetary Fund part of this?
Well, I would say the International Monetary Fund has certainly been set up for the purpose of facilitating that transfer of sovereignty and transfer of wealth on the road.
All right, we elected Mr. Conservative.
Let me just finish the point, because otherwise we're going to have a lot of unanswered questions. That you are looking at a group that has worked to bring about a dissolution of national sovereignties on the road to world government. And certainly you're familiar with the local professor, Carol Quigley, who has been part of your club, in which he admitted all this. And he said in his book, Tragedy and Hope, the only thing I disagree is that we've worked to keep it a secret. And you see Arthur Schlesinger Jr. writing way back in 1947, says, yes, this is the hidden policy of America. He said that the objective, the secret policy, which we can't tell the American public because they're not sophisticated enough to see the value, is that through a steady result of erosion of new deals, we bring the American society steadily to the left,
right,
and through a sound concept of benign containment, we merge into the vital center of the socialist left.
Those are his words, not mine.
All right, what about the effort in Vietnam? Schlesinger was behind the Bay of Pigs. In other words, look, isn't there some move that occurred in the post-war era that now has been dissipated because nobody believes in the utopian ideal of world government anymore?
Well, I think there are those that realize that moving straight from a prototype of the United Nations into world government perhaps is tactically impossible. But phasing out the increasing national sovereignty into regional government and phasing out sovereignties into international treaties in multiple areas
The whole movement toward, quote, interdependence.
Yes.
NATO is part of the conspiracy?
Well, there are certainly elements in NATO. There are people in NATO who are very strongly dedicated to the defense of the West. But at the same time, you find in NATO a steady dissolution. You find a growing weakness as a NATO policy dominated by State Department policies that has not worked.
Well, it's a regional grouping.
The realization of our citizens that they have a fundamental constitutional right to keep and bear arms as the Constitution allows. And unfortunately, there are those in our society, including elements of the PTA nationally, not always locally by any stretch, but nationally, who would believe that the federal government should restrict the right of citizens.
Your public relations director, the John Birch Society, says that Bill Casey is a part of this conspiracy that's trying to bring about world government.
Before he became CIA, one of his big jobs was aiding in the transfer of technology and goods and so forth to the Soviet Union, helping the Camera River Project, the Export-Import Bank. Helping to finance
the Export-Import Bank part of the conspiracy?
I think the fact that the American people have been tapped steadily, especially since World War II, to finance their enemies and to have the massive technology transfer,
the Constitution, and limited government, and free enterprise, and biblical values of morality.
I believe in all those, but I don't believe there's a conspiracy.
He'd make a lousy candidate.
Well, Tom, you know, as a matter of fact, he's not a member of the conspiracy, he's a member of the press.
Let me ask you, Mr. Braden's used for the 47th time the term conspiracy. Now, let me ask you seriously. When you use people like Casey, who's on the Council on Foreign Relations, David Rockefeller's Trilateral Committee, Commission, what do you mean, or do you mean, is that your term, the term conspiracy?
Well, there are many different levels of the problem, but yes, the term has been used, the term of conspiracy, when you have a group of people.
They're actively collaborating, and at the other end of that point of collaboration are communists, and on this end of the point of collaboration is Bill Casey and trilateralists and CFO.
You have people who are part of the elitist structure of this country that have dominated this country openly for 40 years.
I know, but they're not, is that a conspiracy?
Now, wait a minute. If people quietly working together for evil objectives, two or more, that by definition is a conspiracy. You have by their own admission, you look at The Tragedy and Hope by Professor Carol Quigley, who's a member of this elitist group. He says, sure, we've been working this. Sure, we've been collaborating with communism. Yes, we're working for a global accommodation. Yes, we're working for world government. The only thing I object to is that we have kept it a secret. And I think we've gone so far along, we should come out and say,
I'll bet you a dollar and a half that Bill Casey doesn't know who Professor Quigley is. I don't.
He's at Georgetown a number of years ago.
He died a couple of years ago, and he wrote The Tragedy and Hope. He's a very noted member of your club, Tom.
Tom, you've got to broaden your reading a little bit.
That's right. What I ought to do is read more about conspiracies, and that's why I'm interested in
I'll tell you what you ought to do is go back and look at your founder, Edward Mandel House, because he wrote the book Philip Drew Administrator. And in this, Colonel House said that what he envisioned for the world was a world government along socialist lines as envisioned by Karl Marx. Now, that's your leader, Tom, so you got to go back to the beginning.
Well, his leader was Woodrow Wilson. Do you think he was a communist?
No, I think Woodrow Wilson was his follower. I think Edward Mandel House dominated Wilson, not the other way around.
Mm-hmm. And so Edward Mandel House, that was, we ought to make that clear, he was President Wilson's
alter ego, that's correct.
Yeah. So he is the real villain from which all these conspiracies.
No. He is a major figure, Tom. But there has been, unfortunately, in the West, an element. There are good members in the Council on Foreign Relations, dedicated patriotic people. You've had Sproul Braden, who was a member of the Council of the Birch Society.
Bill Buckley's
and Council on Foreign Relations. You've got some dedicated people, but the driving forces have very clearly been willing to collaborate, subsidize, work for technology transfer for what they feel is some type of an accommodation and merger. And I submit this would be a disaster.
attacked by the U.S., that that was the only reason the weapons inspections were having any progress at all.
Well, without that firepower and these awesome weapons being unleashed on Iraq, they are supposed to be defense forces, not offense forces, but this is a very different matter. This is the United States prosecuting its interests, and President Bush makes no bones about this, in bringing in a new world order. That's 5% of the world's population trying to...
A lot of times I'm asked now, where are you getting the support? How come you're doing so well on the Internet? What's going on around here? And I said, well, it just might be that freedom is popular.
Is there a plan for a new world order, a one world government, and how do we stop it?
Well, I think even our first President Bush said that the New World Order was in tune, and that's what they were working for. The UN is part of that government. They're working right now very significantly for North America.
A sovereign nation that protected liberty here at home, and yet traded with people and traveled and were friends with everybody, we still would not need the UN, the IMF, the World Bank, the WTO, the CAFTA, or NASA for the New World Order.
Let me say very clearly that we are not focused, as some have suggested, on establishing a new world order, but rather bringing order to a new world.
There's a need for a new world order, but it has different characteristics.
Ambassadors, you can let all of our worshipers in now. I want to preach, teach, instruct, impart, using as a theme a new world order. A new world order. Look at the person beside you and say, God is setting up. Look him in the eye. Tell him, God is setting up a new world order, and his plan includes you. If you believe it, I dare you to clap your hands even right now.
You will always have a special place in my heart and in the New World Order.
Steps, maybe pull a couple of his teeth for DNA samples.
Mandy, I'm getting presents in the New World Order! Mrs.
Neo-Sapiens, by right of conquest, the homeworlds are ours. The superiority of the Neo-Sapien race has triumphed. Those who opposed us have been crushed. Terrans who accept the Neo-Sapien peace will be tolerated in the New World Order. Those who refuse and resist will be eliminated.
Because the only truth you know is what you get over this tube. Right now, there is a whole, an entire generation that never knew anything that didn't come out of this tube. And when the largest company in the world controls the most awesome goddamn propaganda force in the whole godless world, who knows what shit will be fed over truth on this network. So you listen to me. Listen to me. Television is not the truth. Television's a goddamn amusement park. Television is a circus, a carnival, a traveling troupe of acrobats, storytellers, dancers, singers, jugglers, sideshow freaks, lion tamers, and football players. We're in the boredom-killing business. But you people sit there day after day, night after night, all ages, colors, creeds, We're all you know. You're beginning to believe the illusions we're spinning here. You're beginning to think that the tube is reality and that your own lives are unreal. You do whatever the tube tells you. You dress like the tube. You eat like the tube. You raise your children like the tube. You even think like the tube. This is mass madness, you maniacs. In God's name, you people are the...
He wills. We have confidence because freedom is the permanent hope of mankind, the hunger in dark places, the longing of the soul. When our founders declared a new order of the ages, when soldiers died in wave upon wave for a union based on liberty, when citizens marched in peaceful outrage under the banner Freedom Now, they were acting on an ancient hope that is meant to be fulfilled. History has an ebb and flow of justice, but history also has a visible direction set by liberty and the author of liberty. When the Declaration of Independence was first read in public, and the Liberty Bell was sounded in celebration, a witness said it rang as if it meant something. In our time, it means something still. America in this young century proclaims liberty throughout all the world and to all the inhabitants thereof. Renewed in our strength, tested but not weary, we are ready for the greatest achievements in the history of freedom. And may he watch over the United States of America.
Either you are with us or you are with the terrorists.
It was a breathtaking display of firepower.
And the Pentagon says we ain't seen nothing yet.
Ideas are bulletproof, and the New World Order better stop carrying out terror attacks. We've caught them over 200 times in the last 100 years, Western governments doing this. Hitler does it, the British do it, the Russians did it. Governments do this.
They think nothing of human life, only control and keeping that control. The entire world is being engineered, designed to be a prison planet, a control grid over free humanity. Once you understand their game plan, it's very easy to defeat. Knowing who your enemy is half the battle. Taking action is the other half. You only have to free your mind, and defeating the globalist will be easy.